Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Let's us continue with this session. Let me start introducing myself. You can see my name is Zdenek Tuma, KPMG. But in fact, I probably deserve the invitation to this nice event because I spent 12 years in the Czech National Bank, 10 years as governor. I have the pleasure to moderate this session, this panel of distinguished economists and policymakers, or people who were or have been very close to policymaking. And I think that it's this panel is a very nice follow-up on some of the previous lectures and sessions, because it will focus on capital flows, and obviously it's very closely related to that question whether we can have independent monetary policy in relatively small and open economies. And in fact, especially in transition economies, there's a number of specifics, because typically we don't have the a robust financial architecture, so that on the one hand we need some capital, but quite often it happens that it's too much, sometimes it's not enough. And as we saw in the presentation of Maurice Obstfeld, that for instance foreign direct investment is relatively stable, but it's in global terms. In fact, we know that at the national level there is also a substantial volatility regarding FDI, and it's not easy to maintain the attractiveness of the country for foreign investors. And obviously, portfolio investors, and regarding that, it's even more volatile. So it's the obvious challenge in transition countries, when to open, when to liberalize, how better to apply some administrative measures. It's also the challenge when to switch to floating, and as we know, quite often we observe that fear of floating. Despite the fact that the Czech Republic and the Czech National Bank has been quite successful in that process of switching from fixed exchange rate regime to inflation targeting and floating, still we also experience some tough experience. At the end of the 90s, before the switch from fixed to floating, for instance, the Czech koruna was under pressure for appreciation, so that the central bank should decrease interest rates, but at the same time that could cause some other disequilibria in the economy. And a couple of years later, at the beginning of the previous decade, there was another massive pressure on appreciation of the Czech koruna, so that the appreciation was really fast. And despite the fact that we were applying floating for a couple of years still, so then we used interventions again. So that always there are some challenging situations, so that I'm happy that we have distinguished panelists here. Oleg Churiy, deputy governor from the National Bank of Ukraine, so that he is going to tell us something what's going on at this moment, what's plans, what's the situation in Ukraine. Marek Dabrowski from Bruegel, Brussels think tank, economist and policymaker, very experienced. Andrew Levin, professor of economics from Dartmouth University, but he has spent many years with the Fed, also advising and working with the IMF very closely. And Linda Tesar, also professor of economics from the Michigan University, also very close to policymaking. So that I really look forward to the presentations. The agreement is that we would have some kickoff remarks up to 10 minutes, because it would be fine to use our panelists for the discussion and for your questions. So let me invite Oleg with his introductory remarks. Oleg, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Zdenek. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. The topic of my speech today is Ukraine experience in conducting capital account liberalization. Although, frankly, I would not tell only about liberalization, but also about all these restrictive measures which we imposed a couple of years ago. But what I'm trying to tell you is that I'm the person from the market. I'm with central bank for only 1.5 year, and I would try to tell you about more practical experience of how we imposed all these measures and how we conduct actually liberalization. But I would like to start with the history. I mean, a couple of decades ago, it was considered that capital control was seen as anachronism, and free capital movements were seen as a solution for capital constrained countries. But after financial crisis, we know that IMF reconsidered its long-lasting position of rejection capital control as a tool for financials, which can be used for financial stability. And it now it is widely recognized that capital flow management can be used for these purposes. And as we know from a recent presentation here today, that a number of central banks already added capital flow measures to their toolkit to support financial stability. Coming back to Ukraine, we are now moving in a bit different direction than other countries in the world. I mean, we imposed very strict capital control measures a couple of years ago. Basically, it's not only capital control measures, it's restrictive measures which covered both capital account, it covered current account transactions, operation of commercial banks, and operations of individuals with a foreign currency. To start with, I can tell you that capital flow management can't be used for as a substitution for macroeconomic reforms. And when we introduced these drastic measures, we understood that this capital flow management can be used mainly in order to buy time, in order to make all this reform. And actually, Ukraine did exactly that. We moved from fixed exchange rate policy to floating to flexible exchange rate policy, whereby now we use exchange rate as a buffer against external imbalances. A lot of reforms were done in banking sector. We cleaned up banking system, as our governor said this morning. More than 70 banks went out from the market. We introduced more effective prudential regulation. A lot of things were done for fiscal policy. We get rid of fiscal domination, quasi deficit, which we had for our biggest energy company, almost already completely eliminated. When we introduced all these restrictive measures, we understood that we should think about exit from the beginning. And actually, we elaborated so-called roadmap for gradual removing of all restrictions we imposed. Roadmap, it's not like ad hoc actions, but actually it's a quite comprehensive plan. It consists of several stages, and the plan itself, it's not time-based, it's condition-based. Means if we removing some restrictions, so some conditions have to be met. We consider that sudden removal of all restrictions can destabilize the market and lead to another wave of crisis. That's why we are very cautious. In terms of priority, we defined in terms of priority for capital account liberalization, we defined ourselves like three main areas. One area is we call area to promote economical growth and the production. It means that we first would like to liberalize more stable flows, FDI and current account. The second area, this is development of financial market. We would like to provide market with more liquidity, because with all these restrictions we have in place, actually, central bank act as a market maker of last resorts, and there is not much liquidity at the market. That's why our idea is gradually move from a situation whereby central bank is the main player at FX market to a situation whereby banks provide more flexibility, more more possibility to provide liquidity to the market. And one of the idea is the introduction of a market maker institute in Ukraine. Another area which we would like to launch, this is we call this broader investment and funding options. Here we are calling, we are talking about attracting equity first of all, and then long-term debt capital. But also we are talking about possibility for Ukrainian residents to invest abroad. But this is very, very last stage, and it's definitely not the first one. We consider capital flow management as temporary, and we employ very gradual approach. If we compare us with maybe other countries, for example, Cyprus, so when they introduced capital restrictions, it took them probably 1 year to remove them. If you take Iceland, for example, so they introduced restrictions in year 2008 for just half a year. But now, only last month, the government of Iceland announced that they're going ultimately to start removing these restrictions. That's why what I'm trying to say is that relaxation is a function of underlying conditions. Conditions in Ukraine is definitely very much improved. Now we have a single-digit inflation, we have GDP growth already a couple of consecutive months. We have our reserves increased quite considerably. Now it's about 3.5 months of import. But you should compare a situation when we had during crisis, when we have reserves which account only probably 1 month of import. At the same time, we think that a lot of risks are still in place. And these risks are very vulnerable Ukrainian position, very vulnerable external position. I mean, roughly 80% of Ukrainian exports are commodity linked, and we are very much dependent on commodity prices abroad. Very large share of Ukrainian state debt, actually FX debt, is more than 70%. And I would say the rhryst of the Ukrainian state debt, green debt, local debt, is owned by central bank. This is very much the risk. We also take into account a situation with in the East. So we had a war, and there is always risk of escalation. That's why our approach is very gradual, very very cautious. Relaxation process itself we employ is iterative, with each stage based on the experience of the previous one. And I would say the reaction of the market to each relaxation is a very important component in planning our future steps. And the relaxation process we employ is like trial and experience. What I would like to say as a summary is that restrictions and relaxation process, liberalization process we employed can be used as experience only for countries in very extreme situation. What we had a situation when we imposed this restriction. We have a collapse of trade, we have collapse of GDP, we had war, we had bankrupts, runs, we had almost everything. And we consider that these restrictions we imposed and the process of liberalization is very adequate to the situation which we have and which we have now. In the end, I would like to say that even if we move to more liberal model, it doesn't mean that we would not be able to introduce capital restriction measures, but these capital restriction measures can be used as a macroprudential policy. The problem with Ukraine with introducing any restrictions is actually it might serve as a very bad signal, even if it's meant to somehow limit possible disruptive outflow or possible disruptive inflow. In any case, the market might consider these measures, even if it's macroprudential measures, as a very bad signal. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Oleg. And now the second speaker, Andrew Levin. So let me invite you to the mic.
Well, first of all, let me say very much thanks to the National Bank of Ukraine for hosting this conference and inviting me to participate. I really appreciated the governor's remarks this morning, and there are many of us all over the world who want to see Ukraine succeed. We're behind you, and whatever we can do to help, please feel free to let us know. I also want to say thank you to Canada, to the government of Canada, and to the Bank of Canada in particular. I really admire the Bank of Canada as an institution. I think that it's one of the best run central banks in the world. It's a real model in many ways. I'll talk about that in some ways in my remarks. No institution is perfect. There's always room for improvement. But I think doing regular lessons learned, looking back at the past to try to look at what's worked and what hasn't worked. People in Canada are remarkably modest and willing to look carefully at what's worked and hasn't worked, and that's also part of being a role model. I think having a research conference like this itself is a very strong signal that the National Bank of Ukraine is on the right track, because part of the whole enterprise of research is to look honestly, carefully, scientifically at the facts, to take a fresh look, a creative look, and to try to learn and to do things better. We don't have all the answers, especially in macroeconomic research and monetary research. I'm now teaching at Dartmouth and trying to help my students understand that they can't get everything out of the textbook, that taking a fresh look at things and having working together as a team, no individual expert can have all the answers. So again, I think this conference is a really great stepping stone, a landmark in exactly the kind of work that needs to happen to ensure that Ukraine continues on this course towards success. So what I'm going to talk about in my remarks is mostly focused on monetary policy frameworks. I appreciate that each of the other contributors on this panel have other areas of expertise, and so fortunately for me, the things they're talking about are things I'm not as much of an expert on. Let me just start by talking broadly about a couple aspects of central bank governance and transparency that I think are a useful background here. The first thing is it's really important for a central bank to be insulated both from fiscal constraints and from short-term political pressures. Sometimes it's just called central bank independence. I generally prefer not to use that term. I usually am more specific to say operational independence. In many ways, it's a lot like an employer, a boss, and an employee. In this case, you can think of the employer being the public and the government, the elected officials, and the employee is the central bank. Now, a good boss does not micromanage the employee. They give them a clear assignment, and then they let them make individual decisions. They don't breathe down their neck. They don't sit there at the computer watching every word that they type. But there is monitoring and accountability. And so that same principle is actually very relevant in thinking about how the central bank should work. The central bank needs a clear legal mandate. And in many cases, there's room for improvement to make sure that the mandate is sufficiently clear. Just like an employer needs to give the employee a clear job description and clear objectives for what they're expected to do. But then don't breathe down their neck. And so the central bank needs operational independence to make good judgments in specific decisions. But it also needs to be accountable. And so the process of reporting to the elected officials and to the public is really important to maintain the confidence of the public in the central bank, again, just like an employee, if the employee wants to not have the boss breathing down their neck, the way to make sure of that is to keep your boss informed about what you're doing, and particularly when there's key strategic decisions, to make sure that your boss understands those and is fully on board with the approach that you're taking. Likewise with a central bank. And I think the places where central bank operational independence has been threatened, sometimes it's because of the political system, but I think in many cases it's because the central bank is engaging in a lot of effort to discuss key topics with experts, with economists and with financial market participants, and not enough effort to make sure that elected officials and broadly more members of the public understand the mission of the central bank and what it's doing and why it's making its decisions. It's really critical to preserve that degree of operational independence. So the next thing I want to just, it's very closely related, is there's a very strong rationale for the central bank to be systematic and transparent in its monetary policy decisions. Part of that is as a way of maintaining the broad public support. But the other part is that we know actually from many, many years now of both analytical analysis and empirical evidence that monetary policy is most effective when it's systematic and well understood by the public and by the financial markets. The transmission of monetary policy to the broader economy, to economic growth and inflation is strongest when it's clear and transparent and systematic. It's also best in terms of promoting prosperity and growth, because the more systematic and transparent the monetary policy is, the less uncertainty that there is on the part of the public and the financial markets. Policy uncertainty that's really not necessary can really undermine growth and prosperity. So now let me lay out three principles that I think are very relevant for this specific issue of the capital flows, and particularly when I think of a smaller open economy. I think these are principles that have in some ways been pioneered in Canada. I'm going to talk about them in the case of Mexico, which I think also is a great example to learn from. But these are principles actually that apply remarkably well to a very wide range of countries. I was involved at the International Monetary Fund in a project to develop monetary policy frameworks for low-income countries. Last year, several of us were involved with a technical assistance mission to the Central Bank of Ghana. And the same principles, to a very large extent, apply to a low-income country or a frontier country like Uganda or Ghana, to emerging market countries like Brazil and Mexico, to countries that have been moving into advanced economies like Korea, and of course to the most advanced economies. Essentially the same principles apply very broadly, which gives us a lot of confidence that these principles are actually well-trodden and not just experimental new ideas. They're very well-developed with a lot of evidence behind them. So the first thing is that the central bank does have a paramount task, which is to preserve the unit of account. To make the unit of account is if a country has its own currency, and people are using that in transactions. In order to have a healthy economy, people have to be able to rely on the meaning of that unit of account. When you have high and unstable inflation, it means that that unit of account is very noisy and unreliable, and it makes it very difficult for the economy to grow and prosper. There's no other agency of the government that's responsible for this. It's the central bank's responsibility. So if you're going to have a stable unit of account, it's going to be on the shoulders of the central bank to do that, which is why I think it's a fundamental principle. The central bank has to have a paramount task of fostering price stability. And for most central banks in the modern world, that means keeping inflation expectations firmly anchored. Now, it's not narrow, strict inflation targeting at all. In fact, central banks like New Zealand found that just blindly focusing on one single objective in the short run is a mistake. As Maury Ofsalt said earlier, central banks, of course, have multiple objectives, They're trying to serve the public and promoting prosperity and growth. So the key here is to keep inflation expectations firmly anchored, which means have a medium to longer term inflation goal that's very clear, crystal clear. I think the governor mentioned for Ukraine that that medium to longer term goal is 5%, which seems very sensible to me based on experiences of other countries. That at any given point in time, the private sector understands that goal clearly and sees the actual inflation moving toward the goal over time, not abruptly, but in a gradual way that ensures that the other goals that the central bank is trying to foster are also met. In that sense, I don't actually think they're trade-offs so much as a question of what's the horizon over which it's reasonable to hit the goal. And the governor mentioned this morning for Ukraine a very reasonable horizon of trying to accomplish this over a period of 2 or 3 years, more or less. Seems completely appropriate given that trying to do it faster than that could be very disruptive to economic growth and prosperity. But again, the paramount task here is for the public to understand the meaning of the unit of account. And I think for Ukraine, having a 5% inflation goal seems like a very good way to do that. The second principle is that central banks should only rarely intervene in the foreign exchange market. And again, this is very consistent with what Professor Obstfeld said, essentially about having a floating exchange rate. That it's not an absolute. There are times when intervention is appropriate and effective. I'll talk about that for Mexico. Because it can mitigate transitory fluctuations in exchange markets that are due to liquidity or temporary instability in financial markets, and it can be very appropriate. But again, needs to be transparent and systematic. And I think the progress that central banks have been making over the last 10 and 20 years to try to figure out how to be systematic and transparent when they do intervene into the foreign exchange markets. And the final principle is, again, underscoring what Moray Oswald said, the macroprudential tools are absolutely crucial. Whether they're carried out by the central bank or by another agency of the government, they're crucial for protecting financial stability and ensuring that monetary policy doesn't have to bear the fundamental task of financial stability as well as the task of price stability. Those two things should be generally complementary, but they could be trade-offs, and so having macroprudential tools definitely makes it much easier to accomplish both goals of price stability and financial stability. So let me just spend a couple minutes here now to talk about Mexico. As I said, I think there's some really important lessons learned here, both from things that didn't work so well and things that have worked better. So in particular, it's about 20 years ago now, so it's a little bit easier for us to say, have something that sounds critical when it's long enough ago in the past. Sometimes it's hard to criticize something that's very recent because people get offended. But I think if you talk to people at the Bank of Mexico today, they would agree with virtually everything that I'm saying. Mexico had a complex political background at that time. They had a single party that had been in power ever since the 1920s, the Institutional Revolutionary Party was referred to as the perfect dictatorship because it was viewed as benevolent and serving the public, but nonetheless, every single election, the PRI always won the presidency and the majority in the parliament. The problem happened in 1994. There was a presidential election approaching, and the presidential candidate, the heir apparent, was assassinated. Now, if you want to think about this as an analogy, it's a little bit like what happened when the Archduke was assassinated, in the prelude to the First World War. I mean, it was a terrible event for Mexico because there wasn't anyone second in line to the presidency in Mexico, and so it really created a lot of political instability and uncertainty. Now, at the time, the Bank of Mexico had a crawling peg that was trying to keep the exchange rate stable, and the problem is that crawling peg just did not work in this situation. The Bank of Mexico raised interest rates, but basically, again, very much in line with what Moray Obstfeld described earlier, the Bank of Mexico, over the course of a year, was essentially just drained most of its reserves, foreign exchange reserves, trying to defend the peg. At a certain point, it's actually stopped publishing its reserve data because it realized that if the public learned how low the reserves were getting, that that would actually exacerbate the problem. But in the end, by the end of the year, basically, there was no choice. They had to abandon the peg. So I'm not sure here where we are on the... I'm sorry, I thought you guys were following along here. I'm really sorry about that. I had all these nice... Wow, okay. All right, well, anyway, the good news is the slides will be published on the web, so if anyone wants to see them later, boy, I spent a lot of time polishing these. Okay, so anyway, the good news here, there's some graphs, and at least you can take a look. Okay, so here's the crawling peg during the course of 94, just moving down very slowly. I mean, these are, just tenths of a percentage point here. That was the regime in place. But here's the reserve data, and you can see that from the end of 1993 through December of 94, the reserves almost completely disappear. They're all used up trying to defend a peg that it was unsustainable. So finally, after the new president was inaugurated, the Bank of Mexico had to relent. They dropped the peg. The exchange rate dropped in half, more or less. So it caused an economic and financial crisis in Mexico because people weren't prepared for such a dramatic change in the exchange rate. Okay, now I can't get it to go. Okay. Now, the good news for Mexico is that this provided an impetus to move to a much better monetary policy framework and exchange rate framework. The monetary policy framework was inflation targeting. Mexico was a pioneer in this sense as an emerging market country to move to an inflation target. It took a few years. Again, not so different than what Argentina is currently experiencing and something like what Ukraine may be going through. It took a while to bring inflation down, but by 2002, they were into low single digits and had a clear inflation target, which they've maintained ever since. And so you can see the success of it here. Since 2003, the inflation target's been 3%. They've had a band of plus or minus one around it as indicative of the kind of fluctuations that are happen naturally. And most of the time, it's been pretty close to the target. A couple times it's gone temporarily outside, but expectations have been well anchored throughout the period. As Moria mentioned, lately the problem has actually been inflation being a little bit on the low side. And this is where I think having a buffer for Mexico of having an inflation target of 3 has been a good thing because it means they're not on the verge of deflation. And again, for a country like Ukraine, having a little bit higher inflation buffer I think seems very sensible to me. Now the other part of the modern framework for Mexico is the exchange rate regime, where they've had a strong commitment to a floating exchange rate and only very rare interventions, essentially for practical purposes only during a couple of financial crises in the late 90s and in the global financial crisis. And there is some really nice empirical evidence from economists at the BIS that shows that that intervention actually has been effective in alleviating liquidity problems and reducing the bid-ask spread. So you can see here there have been significant movements in the exchange rate, but also some periods where it was pretty stable. So just to conclude, again, it's really important for central banks to devote resources to educating the public and informing the public about monetary policy, about the exchange rate, about the rationale for central bank in operational independence, to explain the decisions, and to maintain and build up the public confidence. That will help protect the central bank from ever going back to a situation where it's facing a political interference. I'll just say briefly, central banks should identify key risks, not just talk about kind of the benchmark outlook, but key risks and contingency plans for addressing those risks. I think, is an important part of communication. And then finally, as I mentioned earlier, and as several of the papers today have been talking about, the macroprudential tools play a really important role. So I'll stop there.
Thank you very much. And you know, at least people could focus on what you were saying. Well, when you mentioned that the Bank of Canada and their support to Ukraine, I can confirm that it's a systematic support from the Bank of Canada, because in the 90s, the Bank of Canada was very supportive and providing technical aid also to the Czech National Bank, so it's not exceptional. And when you mentioned that importance of the independence and operational independence, it reminded me quite interesting experience 15 years ago approximately, because the Czech National Bank had not only operational independence but also instrumental, so that they could decide on the level of the inflation target itself. And members of the parliament came to the conclusion that it's too much and that that decision should be made with the consultation with the government. I don't have any problem with that, because in the UK, as we know, it's decided by the Treasury, so both models can work. Some central banks decide about it themselves. So that there was a change in the law, and we were obliged to consult with the government. In the end, a couple of months later, it was abolished by the Constitutional Court, because the court said it can threaten the independence, so that's questionable. But what I would like to say, that interesting discussion at the government, because the discussion lasted approximately 1 minute, maybe 90 seconds. It's extremely technical issue, so it doesn't matter so much. Only the prime minister said that's okay and made a couple of comments, so it was quite interesting experience for me. So Marek Dabrowski, may I invite you to the mic. Thank you.
It's working? Okay. First, I would like to thank organizers for inviting me to this excellent conference. I am really amazed with the level of all the papers, the presentation, well, organization, very good organization. Originally, I prepared some sort of textbook presentation on managing capital flows, but in the context of morning discussion, I a bit refocused towards Ukrainian context, and now to save time, I will also skip a few slides, further slides, not to repeat, especially three slides which are talking about forces of financial globalization and benefits and cost of capital account liberalization. This was a fascinating debate in 1990s and very policy relevant in many countries in 1990s, perhaps still in early 2000s. But today I would risk to say that that is largely passé. Why? Because most countries in the world have de facto open capital accounts, even if they still maintain some de jure restriction. So basically, whether we like or not, we must live with large and unrestricted capital movement. I think that Ukraine is excellent example of the situation, with all existing capital and even current account restriction. It's a country which is very open to capital movement. And frankly speaking, to the best of my knowledge, I cannot imagine effective capital control in Ukraine when the largest business group have the mother, sister, or daughter structure offshores. So I think that idea that we can, you know, manage these flows, I think is very problematic. In practice, a capital account or even more current account restrictions, they hit small business. They do not hurt large business. Population, of course, operates larger on on informal black markets. So basically, this is reality in which we live. And if we live in such a world, we should think about consequences. And of course, we can discuss various consequences of unrestricted capital movements, and I would concentrate on two. One is consequences for balance of payment management, and second one for monetary policy, the topic which was already discussed before, so I will only try to add a few comments. And again, let me skip a few slides which describe, I would say, theoretical assumption about on balance of payment analysis, and let me concentrate on some practical consequences. Traditionally, I would say, in the world of largely closed capital accounts, balance of payments management concentrated first on current account. So we policymakers had to look to competitiveness forces and also macroeconomic policy for the domestic absorption. So all factors which determine trade balance and then current account balance. And the next task, very often an easy task, was how to finance current account deficit, because it was current account surplus, so it was not a big problem, always at least via central bank reserves, international reserves, it could be exported. But when it was current account deficit, then it was the question how to finance this current account deficit. And if they couldn't finance, that was necessity for policy adjustment. Typical justification of IMF programs 1980s or early 1990s. But now, very often, we have completely different situations. These are capital accounts, which drive all balance of payment story. And again, if we look for Ukraine, or more broadly, for former Soviet Union, Central Eastern Europe, for example, the last financial crisis experience, they were mostly driven by capital accounts. Think about 2008, 2009. It was sudden stop in global capital flows, which affected most of the countries, even if many of them were had relatively good domestic macroeconomic fundamentals. They had adjust rapidly, so current account had to adjust to capital account. And with all consequences for domestic absorption, output growth, employment, etc., and of course exchange rates, real exchange rates. So, and the same also if we think about the latest series of currency crises in Ukraine, in Russia, in Azerbaijan, in Kazakhstan, practically in all former Soviet Union. They are also driven very much by a capital account. For example, Russia never had a current account deficit. Even in 1998, it still had small current account surplus. But extraordinary large capital outflow in 2008-09 and now 2014-15, it's caused the crisis, collapse of ruble. The same, more or less, in Azerbaijan, which, by the way, had many formal restrictions on capital accounts, and in spite of having 20 years of currency stability, what no other former Soviet Union country, apart from Baltics, experienced, it also was affected by capital account crisis last year. So this is the situation in which most national policymakers must live. And the question is whether we have economic policy instruments on national level to manage, again, question about if we cannot formally control capital flows, so perhaps we can affect in some other ways. I would say that we have some, but very limited, and sometimes the effect is very hard to predict. We had session on macroprudential regulation. It may play some role. Monetary policy may have some role, but very limited. Fiscal policy, for example, countries which could create and build sovereign funds that to some extent they could sterilize capital inflow in good times and could have some buffers in bad times. But these are only partial effects. So basically, this is maybe not very pleasant perception, but basically, this is the same concerns, for example, real exchange rate. But still, situation on current account, even if it's driven by changes in capital account, matters. So if current account rises too large, it may cause speculation against currency, may create perception that is a position of a given currency is fragile. So it's very, very, very difficult situation, and I don't have too much time now to go more specifically in individual policy measures. Now, and this is the illustration how in some regions, Central Eastern Europe, Latin America, current account balance reflected changes in net capital flows before the and during the global financial crisis. And wait, it doesn't work. Oh, okay, sorry. In the former Soviet Union, this was not exactly like this because of the presence of oil and resource rent in some countries like Russia or Kazakhstan, and also because of remaining restriction at that time on free capital movement. Now about capital mobility and monetary policy. Again, I don't want to repeat things which were discussed. I support the view that it very much the room of maneuver in national monetary policy against what is trends created by largest central bank very much depends on how big changes in exchange rate, economy, society, and politics of a given country can sustain. Of course, this also depends on the size of economy, sophistication, diversification, depths of financial market, how this financial market works, etc. But evidently, if there are too sharp changes in exchange rate, even under flexib exchange rate regimes, this creates several unexpected and undesired side effects in terms of financial sector stability, in terms of competitiveness of real economy, export, import, etc. And also what I will come shortly, also it affects very often, especially in case of depreciation, sharp depreciation, attitude to domestic currency of domestic currency holders. And so I would say that, of course, if we think about medium-sized economy, with a well-established credibility, let's say, for example, Sweden, this is not a big problem, probably. But in several emerging market economies, and particularly in countries of former Soviet Union, in Latin America, in part of Central Eastern Europe, I mean countries of former Yugoslavia, this is a quite serious problem. And why this is a serious problem? Because there is another phenomenon, which is not exactly, is partly related to financial globalization, but not only. This is currency substitution. And currency substitution existed also in closed economies. Think about Soviet Union, where holding foreign currency and even more making transactions foreign currency was subject of criminal prosecution, but still people held foreign currency for good, many good reasons, keeping their wealth. Of course, financial globalization increased opportunities of currency substitution, decreased transaction cost, makes it legal. We can think, of course, about limiting currency substitution. It was today discussion also that we can think about restricting, for example, foreign currency denominated loans, etc., various other macroprudential measures. But it cannot stop what is the most important and many countries the most risky is spontaneous dollarization, spontaneous cash dollarization, which is caused usually by combination of various historical legacies like high inflation, hyperinflation, past currency crisis, past non-equivalent currency reforms, lack of political stability, lack to trust to government and government policy, and many other things. And let me make one small digression. Today morning was mentioned helicopter money and quantitative easing. I must say this as person experience with Ukrainian economy that Ukraine tried with helicopter money. It was not called helicopter money. It was called direct credit to agriculture, to various sectors in 1992, 1993. And the effect was very clear, hyperinflation in December 1993. And also various quasi-fiscal roles of National Bank of Ukraine continued quite long time. And I am not sure were completely abandoned until now. And so I think the situation, this is not only the situation of Ukrainian economy. Again, let's think about what happened in the last 24 months in all countries of former Soviet Union. So this is a sort of legacy which is not easily to get rid of. It's as usual that credibility can be lost very easily, and rebuild takes years, decades, and it's not so easy. And of course, in case of, this is one of the reasons which, again, makes probability of sharp exchange rate changes in as transmission of various external shock more probable. Because apart from the depths of financial markets, apart from economic diversification, there is also psychological reaction of economic agents, especially of population, which must be taken here. And this transmits immediately on prices. It also creates various kind of portfolio problems. Even if banks can be closely watched and eliminate currency mismatches, it's practically impossible to do in case of non-financial enterprises. So again, it's a very complicated problem. So this also, I think, to a certain extent explains this phenomenon of fear of floating, as described by Calvo and Reinhardt. And this is really a real problem. This is also answer why introducing exchange rate flexibility in countries of former Soviet Union takes so long time. I don't want to question that exchange rate flexibility has a number of advantages, as explained by Maurice Obstfeld, but we also must be aware that this it has its limits, especially if we if we deal with economies which have these historical fragilities. Thank you very much.
Marek, thank you very much. Regarding floating and fear of floating, I can confirm that it's the certain process. It's not the decision to switch to inflation targeting. It doesn't mean that overnight you set up the inflation target and that everything has changed. It's about the mentality of the central bank. You need the processes must be changed, and you must think in a different way about the monetary policy. So, for instance, when I mentioned intervention in 2001, in 2002, in fact, it was still, despite the fact that for 3 years we had floating, poor floating, in fact, that still there was some kind of aspect of the mentality of the fixed exchange rate. And I believe that a couple of years later, we wouldn't use interventions and we would have been more aggressive on interest rates, for instance. So it's not so easy and it's really a process. So now our last, but was it not least, speaker, Linda Tesar. And I understand that one of your research interests is capital flows in transition countries. May I ask you, do you have also some family ties to the Central and Eastern Europe? Because the name Tesar is quite frequent in the Czech Republic. So
yes, it's.
So the mic is yours.
Okay. I'm going to. Is this on? Can you hear me? Okay. So I'm going to also take. Because I move around when I talk. So I'm going to stand here and also so I can see my slides. Let me say first on my last name, it's my husband's name. I took my husband's name, and his family did come from the Czech Republic long ago. It was not called the Czech Republic then. And let me say also a thank you for the invitation to speak at this conference. It's been a wonderful day. I've learned a lot. And we've covered so many issues, and as the last speaker, many of the things have already been covered. So I'm going to, I have many slides and I'm not going to go through all of them, but I'll try to hit on the ones that I think might have something slightly different than what you've already heard today. So I'm going to take kind of the global overview on sort of where are we at in terms of thinking about the costs and benefits of globalization. And so it's not going to be very specific to the issues in Ukraine, but maybe in having this kind of overview, it'll open up the discussion, and so that's the perspective. So, you know, going way back, when I think about when I first started working on, when I was a graduate student, thinking about capital market integration, I think those were very optimistic, heady times. The Washington consensus was that there would be many, many benefits from the globalization of financial markets. And I'm not going to talk about what they are. We've all read them in the textbook. Really, my talk is about sort of the reality check that we've all had on what globalization and capital flows have delivered and what they haven't delivered, and how we now, what lessons we might have learned from that process. So, you know, I guess one very, again, very broad overview way of thinking about, you know, what was the Washington consensus. In some ways it was, well, if you get prices right, meaning undertake the reforms so that domestic prices and the exchange rate are basically the efficient prices, then things will be allocated efficiently and all will work out well. Of course, and I'll show you in a second, as we know, lots of restrictions to capital barriers came down. And capital did flow, indeed, across countries. But that flow was followed by a sequence of financial crises, which then led to, I think, a kind of a revision of the Washington consensus, which was then that getting market prices isn't enough, we need to get institutions right. And indeed, that's been a theme that's come up over and over, the importance of regulations and the central role for government policy. So again, I'm not going to list all of the ways that people had thought that capital market integration would deliver strong benefits. But one thing we haven't really talked about much today is I think there was this idea as well that because of the more efficient allocation of capital globally, that capital would move from places where capital was abundant to regions where capital was more scarce, that this would lead to a more globally efficient allocation of capital. At a minimum, it would help countries kind of liberalize savings and would end up growing faster and reaching the frontier quicker. Maybe even more optimistically that through capital being reallocated, along with that would come the transmission of technology across countries, and that would spur, in the long run, faster rates of economic growth. Whoops. As I mentioned, clearly we did see falling barriers to capital flow. This is taken from work by Menzi Chin and Ito, and the line going up means that the barriers are lower. So the top line is showing the index of capital mobility for industrialized countries, and indeed you see a continuous increase in that index. Emerging markets and less developed countries had falling barriers later in the process. What I want to, in updating this figure, I thought it was interesting to see, it's been mentioned that capital controls are more often now part of the policy toolkit, and indeed you see kind of a decline in the extent of openness, not just in emerging markets and less developed countries, but in industrialized countries as well. And indeed, we saw a rapid increase in capital flows across countries. You can see that I've stopped the clock here strategically at 2005. I'll show you some figures what happened during the financial crisis, but you can see this boom in capital flows, and in particular, portfolio and debt flows, and flows through bank loans. And a lot of it went to developing countries, as one might hope, if capital is going from capital abundant to capital scarce regions of the world, one would hope that there'd be capital flow to emerging markets and developing countries, and indeed there was, and a lot of it was in the form of foreign direct investment. But that said, what I've shown you here is this is global inward foreign direct investment. The blue line is global flows. The red line is flows to advanced countries. And you can see flows have increased over time, but predominantly the flows are among advanced economies. And the same thing is true of portfolio investment. Also, if we thought part of the purpose of globalized markets and a more efficient allocation of capital, you might think that this would lead to a more even distribution of capital and a more even distribution of wealth across countries, at least in the long run. So what I've done here is to take some data. This is drawn from the work by Jean-Marie Amalesi-Ferretti and Philip Lane, where they've done sort of the stock. And so this is taking the capital, the capitalized value of capital in each country, and then adding to that the external assets and liabilities to capture that portion of wealth. And if wealth were evenly distributed across countries, you'd be right along the 45-degree line. Clearly we're not, and indeed it hasn't even moved all that much over time. And the same story basically holds for the capital stock. There's two pictures here. One is got a smaller set of countries, so I just wanted to do a broader set. So you can see we didn't really experience this reallocation of wealth across countries that we might have optimistically hoped for. So we saw reduced home bias in investment portfolios, more flows to emerging markets, boom in emerging market stock markets. But the distribution of capital remained pretty heavily distributed or remained in advanced economies. We also see another metric for thinking about whether there are gains from capital market liberalization would be whether countries can smooth consumption relative to their incomes, or are they getting diversification benefits. And indeed, one of the things we see is that capital flows to emerging markets are pro-cyclical, which would suggest that maybe they're not really, they're kind of amplifying the cycle as opposed to smoothing the cycle. So I'm going to skip over this because I don't want to go on too long. But I think we can see that the link between financial market openness and indeed there were a number of crises that followed. So there were a number of risks. So how has our perspective changed in the aftermath of the global financial crisis? Here you can see what happened to gross capital flows during the financial crisis. Certainly we saw a drop in global GDP, kind of a blip down in the blue line. You see a blip down in trade, but you really see this massive decline in global capital flows with the global financial crisis, which hasn't yet fully recovered. And you can see, as we all know, I'm telling you what you already know, the majority of the slowdown was in flows between banks. So it also took a toll on risk sharing. So this is looking at what happened to the volatility of income and the volatility of consumption. And what you can see is that there was this downward trend in the volatility of consumption through diversification, through the better management of business cycles. But then you see an uptick post the financial crisis, so increased risk. Let me just flip forward. So in some sense, I think, and again, this is repeating things that we've said throughout the day, I think we were looking for risk in some of the wrong places prior to the global financial crisis. The focus by academics like myself, and I think policymakers, was to focus on aggregate flows. Of course, there was work on the composition of flows, but I don't think there was really a focus on that. It was really thinking about capital flows in the aggregate. There was some focus on exchange rate exposure, but by and large, maybe not as much emphasis on that as there should be. And I think emerging markets, the crises in emerging markets, certainly provided clues that to be not paying attention to what was going on, both with the composition of flows, but also what was happening in the financial sector, was going to prove to be a big problem. So I think the financial crisis has forced us to review our thinking on capital market integration. The role of the financial sector is paramount. The importance of financial regulation. I think now there's much more focus in our thinking, as there should be, and this came up earlier, on the role of debt. The efficiency of the financial sector. How large should the financial sector be? This is a question to which we don't really have a good answer. And the central role of policy. As I said, and as has been commented earlier today, that capital controls have reemerged as an important tool in managing capital flow. I think, you know, this was essentially taboo, I think, several years ago, but now I think it's become an important part of the toolkit. And I just want to kind of end on this note. I think we can all kind of articulate what capital controls can do to help manage capital flows and you know, manage the composition and maturity of flows. And it was mentioned earlier that it can provide kind of a protective barrier, provide some time and a buffer for the domestic economy to deal with weaknesses in the financial sector and make the necessary reforms. That said, I just want to throw out kind of a cautionary note that I think the pendulum has kind of swung to a more optimistic view about capital controls, but I think we need to take this with a bit of caution in that by having the capital barrier there, you take the pressure off the kinds of reforms that need to take place. Furthermore, with that barrier there, economic agents, of course, are responding to incentives, and with the barrier there, are taking positions incorporating the role of these capital controls. potentially making it harder in the end, both politically and economically, to take those controls away. So, you know, there's been a discussion about that capital controls are helpful and they can be helpful as a temporary measure. But there's a real time consistency issue, because you might ex ante say temporarily it's a good thing to do, but I think and one can write down models where it makes sense to have these temporary controls in there. I think what hasn't really been worked out, both in theory and in practice, is what's the optimal sequence for taking them away, and how do you commit to that ex ante? So I'll end there, and hopefully this will trigger some discussion. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much to all panelists, and now the floor is open to your questions, and use this opportunity to ask them and to focus on what's interesting for you. Yes. Can we ask the mic here?
When we consider the possible costs or consequences of capital flow management, one thing that I invite comment on that we might need to highlight is the excuse it could give for otherwise bad behavior, a way of legitimizing misdeeds. And here I'm thinking of certain countries who will go unnamed, who used capital flow management and very active intervention to try and systematically undervalue their exchange rate and accelerate growth to the detriment of global stability in the form of exaggerated imbalances. Now, the crisis that emerged in the end wasn't quite what we had anticipated as a result of this, but you could argue that some of the financial imbalances that did trigger the crisis were in fact a consequence of things like savings gluts and so on. So I guess I just invite comment from the panel on this before, as Linda suggested, we get too enthused about capital flow management, sort of the politically correct term for capital controls now. So, thank you.
Okay. Anybody would like to respond or just comment? Yeah. Okay. Another. Yes, Mr. Governor.
Question to Mr. Dabrowski, because you are absolutely right that all CIS countries always had very tough restrictions in capital control, and nevertheless, all businesses right now and all big corporations and their corporate rights, all of them in offshore, and they're using different type of transfer pricing mechanism and different type of, it's not, we're talking not only CIS countries. For example, the same happened in China. They never were brave enough to diminish all these capital controls. And finally, you know, in light of this Panama scandal, it could be, of course, BVI scandal, even Delaware state scandal, because all of them offshore jurisdictions. And that's why we can assume even that Ukrainian business, because of all these 25 years of legacy in all these capital restrictions and all this foreign exchange control, maybe it's time for all this country to start to think about liberalization. What do you think?
Well, definitely, if I didn't tell this clearly enough, I am in favor of liberalization. Not necessarily because this is ideal solution. I acknowledge that there are costs, there are risks, and I thought a lot about this risk. But my bottom line is that I don't believe in effective capital controls in contemporary world. What you can achieve is you may change the structure of capital flows. Perhaps you may push something underground. You can create more corruption, less transparency, less knowledge about what is going in the economy, because if you have certain type of transaction illegal, you don't know then in statistic what is really going on in given economy. Your point about China is absolutely correct, to extent which I understand this economy. I have not so good knowledge of China as of Ukraine, for example, but also, well, it's enough to look for BIS or IMF statistics. Was huge capital outflow in the last 3 years from China, despite all capital controls. So, and probably there are similar mechanisms observed in Ukraine or Russia, and Latin America, etc. So, for me, it's additional argument that we should recognize the nature of the world in which we live and try to not reject reality, I would say. I think that you always need to be realistic economic policy making of any kind, so you shouldn't fight something which is you cannot win, so because this is a lost game from the very beginning. And I would say, especially in Ukrainian context, where internally and internationally, fighting corruption is one of the top issue, and for good reasons. I would comment this way, that I never believed in the effectiveness of fighting corruption itself without getting rid of source of corruption and making economy more transparent. And definitely I think that making financial capital flows free may only help in this task rather than helping something different. So thank you very much.
So let me just elaborate on this a little bit, because I think what I believe the evidence shows clearly is that you can control capital inflows. It's possible. That's in some sense what China's done effectively. You can prohibit foreigners from purchasing domestic companies. You can make it virtually impossible for them to invest in domestic equities. Restricting capital inflows is possible to do. What's virtually impossible to do for any extended period of time is to control capital outflows. And the fundamental reason for that is because it's just too easy to adjust trade transactions. You know, I have a cousin in Los Angeles. I just call him and tell him to charge me a little bit more for the cotton. And it's impossible for the government to monitor every single transaction. And so in effect, I'm just transferring money abroad in the form of a higher invoice. So there's a lesson here, though, I think, for Ukraine, which is that what the sentiment I'm hearing is probably to get rid of a lot of the controls that maybe were intended to try to limit capital outflows and that are not effective and that are just making the system opaque and susceptible to corruption. But I want to look forward to the day, I hope it's not very far away, because it certainly has happened in many other countries. As Ukraine becomes successful, it's going to be a country that people want to invest in, and you will start to have a surge of capital inflows. And I think that the issues that Maury Oswalt raised, and again, I hope you weigh in here if I'm misrepresenting anything, about macroprudential policy is that having a large sudden surge of capital inflows can be destabilizing, partly because it can be reversed and have a sudden outflow later. And so managing the capital inflows carefully, and I wouldn't necessarily use the word controls, but managing the capital inflows, making sure that they're directed to prudent uses, toward productive investments, not toward wasteful consumer spending, that if corporations borrow from abroad, that setting some of that aside if it's a foreign currency obligation, that's macroprudential, and that's urgent, and Ukraine will, I have every reason to believe, will be facing that challenge in the not-too-distant future, and so thinking hard about the capital inflow management is going to be a challenge that we all hope you'll face soon.
I dream about this challenge.
Oleg.
May I also add, the capital flow management
is effective. It depends on how you would like to enforce these measures. For example, in Cuba, I think this capital flow management is very effective. Yeah. On the other hand, on the other hand, if you're talking about restrictions on capital inflow, I think this is really, really very important, because there is the last crisis we had in the year 2008 was partially the reason for this was very large inflow of foreign currency, which was channeled not to productive activity but to real estate market, which create this boom and bust situation. That's why I think it's very important for Ukraine when we liberalize not to forget about managing this inflow, because inflow in the end might end up with very disruptive outflow. Yeah, this is very important.
Okay, so Marek, the last comment, and then let's go.
Well, I first again, maybe I am wrong, but I think perception based on some knowledge is that both inflows and outflows in Ukraine are generated largely by, I would say, resident or close to resident, even if this is, you know, I would say, ex-post-Soviet capital on various offshores, not going, which individual is which nationality, we know what we are talking about. And also large part of the inflow before 2008 was generated by this from this sort of sources. There was some inflow of EU capital or other capital, but large part of this inflow, both FDI and portfolio investment, was generated by I would say post-Soviet offshores. So here, I think again, monitoring is very problematic, and also from broader experience of countries which we try to monitor or control inflows, it usually works in short term. Then always, contemporary financial market is so sophisticated that always find some way to circumvent this restriction. I can also show examples of countries which, for example, explicitly prohibit purchasing some sort of real estate by foreigners, and this also can be easily circumvented, by various legal persons, etc., etc. So I am not sure that this is. I think this is very important to have good macroprudential and microprudential supervision of the banking sector, of other segments of financial market. Also, when we talk about real estate boom potential, this is again taking care on banking sector, how much it lends and on which condition and etc. But I am not sure that exactly looking only for one component, meaning capital inflows, it's very productive here.
Okay, so the hand over there.
Thank you very much. I will have just one remark and one question to panel speakers. We're talking about future Ukrainian experience with capital account liberalization, or we're talking about Ukrainian experience with capital account controls? This is my remark. And my question, I had a chance to be involved in the debate and discussion about the FX liberalization, and I don't see anyone who is objecting this direction, so everyone is on the same boat. And the debate I had, it was about the speed of liberalization. I'm on the side of the quite fast liberalization without any phase one, two, three, and so on, where you can create a lot of some indicators, conditions, and depending on how situation will develop, you can adjust your plan. You need also to have on board society, business community, other policymakers, etc. If you were in the central bank shoes, if you have such a theoretical possibility, in Oleg's shoes, for example, what option you will choose? Option one, or go more complicated way? Thank you very much.
Okay, Marek.
Definitely, I think the thing which should be done relatively quickly in Ukraine is lift current account restriction. This is, I think, must. And then we can discuss what further steps in what sequence. But I think current account transaction restriction are very painful for economy, especially for small and medium-sized business. And they also have high reputation cost internationally.
I guess the only thing I would say is I think blanket statements about capital controls or capital flow management is just really difficult. It's very situation specific, so I would not presume to give that kind of specific policy advice. I'm sure the experts on the ground know a lot more about the specific details and would do a better job. I do think that's one of the dangers, is to draw kind of big conclusions, and I think it really depends on situational, what's happening on the ground in thinking about capital flow management.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Yuri Prodorov, Ukrainian Society of Financial Analysts. I have two questions. My first question is traditionally for Deputy Government of NBU, Oleg Churiy. What do you think about connection with privatization processes in Ukraine now and perspective of massive capital inflow in Ukraine and the acceleration of FX liberalization? What is the first, privatization or liberalization, or vice versa? And my first, second question for Pan Marek Dabrowski. Pan Marek is a very, very many-year big friend of Ukraine and have a big experience of economical reform in Ukraine. What do you think about perspective of pensional reform in Ukraine? And without liberalization of capital accounts for new non-government pension funds, like in experience of Poland. Thank you.
Okay, so Oleg, will you start?
Talking about liberalization process, as I said, it's not time-based, it's condition-based. Yeah, we are lifting our restrictions if we have certain conditions met. And conditions are basically macroeconomic stabilization and, for example, accumulation of currency reserves. Lifting the restrictions, we understand that we create some additional demand and we might have less supply. But having privatization in place and having a large inflow of possible investors into Ukraine with all foreign currency, of course, we would be able to fasten, to speed up the process of liberalization, no doubt about this, yes. And we are very much hope for this, actually.
Well, maybe I could just add a couple of comments here. So in the financial crisis, there's a kind of notion of something called a fire sale, which is that when things aren't going very well, you can buy an asset very cheaply and make a lot of money because a year later things are sort of back to normal. So I think I would be cautious with privatization to make sure that you're not giving away something that's actually going to be increasing in value a lot and essentially giving a gift to whether it's a domestic investor or a foreign investor. I think the other thing I would emphasize is the importance of transparency, both in terms of the actual process of privatization and in terms of what's going to be done with the funds that are coming in. I think that the extent to which privatizations in many countries have been incredibly helpful, even if it is a foreign investment, that provides funds to make that enterprise productive again can be tremendously helpful. And likewise, the proceeds of the privatization can be used by the government to build schools or infrastructure or to replenish the pension system And you can have very broad public support for the privatization, that everyone benefits from it, but it has to be transparent so the public at the end of the day has confidence that this was a good thing for the public and not just for some exclusive set of people.
Okay, Marek.
On pension reform, I think this is a very important thing for various reasons, for fiscal reasons, for social reasons, for labor market reasons. And the most important things is to move faster with increasing the statutory pension retirement age and also eliminating all early retirement privilege and cleaning up the system of disability pensions. It's quite clear that country cannot sustain situation when dependency ratio is close to one and pension expenditures, if I am not wrong, is above 15% of GDP, so close to 15%. So this is absolutely unsustainable, especially if we take demographic perspective of Ukraine. So I am very happy to hear during this visit that new government decided to complete process of bringing energy prices up to cost recovery. This was very important thing. I think the next urgent and important step is about doing reform, pension reform, but I think largely about first pillar pay as you go. Then what else is up to debate? Personally, based on, I would say, experience of other countries, sometimes not very, very optimistic. I would say that I personally opt for the model when you have healthy first pillar based on defined contribution, not defined benefits. And then you have something which is called third pillar, meaning voluntary private pension fund, of course, regulated by government. But here, I think it's very important to have first macroeconomic stability and also have finish sanation of the banking sector, financial sector, because otherwise you risk another, another bubble of something like this. So here I would not hurry so much, but of course I think debate is very much needed. And what direction, because building such system also takes time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. In fact, we approach the end of our time slot, so perhaps if there's a last question to our panelists. Okay, the last one.
Darius Josati, Warsaw School of Economics. We've been talking about the management of capital flows. What's your opinion on the financial transaction tax? This has been an idea floated in the European Union, and a group of member states have agreed to introduce something like that. What's your opinion? Is it possible to indeed achieve the goals of reducing the scope of speculative flows without actually harming the productive flows? To all of you, whoever wants to answer.
The last question is to all. Marek will start, okay.
My opinion is negative, and largely for the reason that this idea comes in the period of time when we observe serious financial disintermediation. If we look for monetary statistics of the largest central banks like Fed, like ECB, Bank of Japan, everywhere, money multiplier is going down for various reasons. Also this is, but one of the reasons is there are, I would say, cost of tighter financial regulations. This I consider is necessary because we cannot longer live in the world which we lived before 2008. Of course, there is problem of pace, of phasing, etc. My private opinion is that in EU, it was Eurozone, it was not necessarily well faced in terms of time, but this is another matter. But financial costs, financial transaction tax adds additional burden. So this additional factor of financial disintermediation. And to my surprise, I now will not quote concrete names, but it's quite large group of economists who call for even looser monetary policy, but at the same time they require putting this transaction tax. It's completely inconsistent one with other, in my opinion.
Okay, Oleg.
Basically, we had a very bad experience with tax on FX transactions. Yeah, and frankly, I'm not very much in favor of imposing such or similar taxes again. I think it simply decreases liquidity and efficiency of financial markets. That's it, yeah.
So Andrew and Linda are not nodding, so it's...
I don't think it goes to the heart of what the issues were that led to the global financial crisis. I think greater capital requirements, more coordination across international borders so that we have synchronized regulation of banks. I think those go much more to the heart of the problem than the transaction tax.
So just to elaborate, I think focusing on liquidity, I mean, again, I'm going to just extend, I think, what Maury said earlier. You know, the currency mismatch is a potentially big problem in a country where you want to have a floating exchange rate. And so that needs to be identified, how much risk there are in the banking system, in shadow banking, in corporate borrowing. The liquidity issues, the capital buffers, those are all macroprudential tools. I just don't see the logic, frankly, of having a tax that applies to every single financial transaction, regardless. That just seems like it's a recipe for heading in the wrong direction.
Okay, so thanks a lot. And so let's thanks to our panelists and also to your questions. Thank you very much.